Meeting each time.
Hey guys, welcome to a Consult ROI podcast. We're going to get the ball rolling, get right into it. So we are going to do a mind mapping first. I know we originally talked about some of the processes or systems, but really it's more of a fundamental to kind of rehash your earlier podcast that I did, which is mind mapping itself. How do we do that? How do we make sure that we get effective execution on our day? And how do we really get all the ideas out on paper to execute, whether you are a business owner or a person that just really has no idea what they want to do, you have an established business and you're just trying to get up to the next level, or your employee that's just trying to get to the next level of their career or do a career change in that. Either way, the beginning and the fundamentals of that is creating a mind map to actually get there. Being able to, and this is something I've said time and time again, if you are consistently, like if you put something into your GPS, if you put nothing into your GPS and you have no destination, no nothing in that, how do you ever expect to get there? Right? If you don't even know the direction, you're driving circles in that for hours and ends, and that you're just going to burn a lot of gas, a lot of energy, but you'll never actually get anywhere that you want to go. So find the fundamentals to get to your where you actually want to get in life. So I'm actually going to show, if you are seeing, if you're watching the audio version of this, you're not going to be able to see this, but I am going to share kind of an insight into one of our mind maps that we've done. So this is one of our master classes. And in case you're just listening to the audio only version, the simple version of this is it's a thought process. Okay, what step? If then, then what? What value are we providing? How are we doing this? What structure in that? What order? What is the fundamentals of that? So like one of the master classes we're doing is what is the key to all successful business owners, which is mental discipline. It's grit. It's the consistency behind that. Perfectionism is the enemy of progress. And then what is the next step? Like, how do you scale your business to the next level? Mastery of leadership. Business starts with you, your own mental determination. What does it mean to become a good leader, meaning by owning everything? So this is one of the masterminds that we're actually building, which would be for business leaders that are going to be as part of our class. We even have ones that are a lot more detailed, a lot more oriented in that, that even breaks down individual sales processes. Like I was just helping actually an HVAC company not too long ago, and I had to break down the fundamentals. That because you'd be surprised if you just break down even basic processes, like what is your sales process? Okay, if the customer says this, then I say this, or split out into the two options that they're going to potentially say. Then if they say this, what is the sayings that I'm going to say, or what are the options that I'm going to do? And based on those, you map it out to where you get the end result. Sometimes it even helps to map it backwards, which is the end result you want as a salesperson or a business owner is the sale itself. So if you're mapping that out, you would do a simple thing where, you know, we can actually do even a new one. You know, I'll do that later. But so we'll do something as simple as like this. So I want sale. And in order to do that, I have to provide value. And if I do that, I have to do etc. But typically they will say, okay, I'm selling. I mean, it could be literally anything from solar to IT to HVAC to whatever. And then you can say, okay, if they come in from a cold lead, that so it's one of your door-to-door salesmen, or it's one of your Facebook ad campaigns. Obviously, how you're going to handle those is very different because one's going to be a warm lead, one's going to be a cold lead. So each one you have to map out and put the individual so you can put people into a template and put, again, this goes back to even our earlier podcast, predictable processes equal predictable results.
Yep.
Right? So if you do and build out all of these, it really makes a very simple thing and process to where you can map it out. And if there's a flaw, like you consistently get held up on one step, then map it out. They're like, hey, we're getting this rebuttal. So do I need to fix what I'm saying to them? Or do I need to fix a response that addresses them to make that? But again, it's not about working for every single person flawlessly. It's about the majority. If you can get 90, like, for example, national, here, I'm going to actually look this up real quick. The percentage. So basically, what I'm looking up is how, what is the, and maybe you should do this, Danny, is look up the percentage of free throws that an NBA player gets. It's a very low percentage. I don't know the exact percentage off the top of my head of that, but the percentage of actual free throws that they actually do sink, or their shot score or whatever else, it's fairly low. And it just shows you, frankly, that there you do not need to be 100% or hit every single one to be making stupid money or be very successful at what you do. And so if you go within it with it, with that understanding, like if you, for example, when you first step into an arena, you might only make one out of every 50, right? So it's going to be atrociously awful. But as you gain expertise, as you gain experience in that, then you're going to get that number reduced, which just means that as you get that number reduced and streamlined, and especially if you do a map to actually figure out where your hiccups are, that expedites the process, which then allows you to close at a higher rate, which means that instead of having to make up skill in numbers, you can do now a lot more numbers with a lot less results. But again, if you're putting in the same effort as if you had no expertise, no efficiency, no qualifications, and you're still closing at a consistently higher rate, how much more successful are you going to be consistently in everything you do? Again, whether it's your business, whether it's your sales job, whether it's your career in general, it is. That's why I believe that sales really is the key to success in anything. And even if you hate sales, it is necessary to be able to do, like, have the fundamentals of how sales works, or how those, that thought process works, and that understand that cause and effect, because that is the key paramount and a key indicator whether you're going to be successful or not in any field. So were you able to find that, by the way?
You know, it's got all sorts of stats all over the place, really. Like it's it says kind of, it's
the 1 in 10 number. What is,
it's like nothing. And like, clearly it just kind of shows like a few different players, like says like Steph Curry, a 0.9087%, Steve Nash 0.9043, Mark Price 0.9039. So like, that's kind of the upper echelons. There was another article in there that said of 26 free throws shot, 19 were made and stuff. So it's like, they're not hitting 100% of the time, right? Not, nobody is, right? But it's that consistency over time. And the NBA, what's fascinating about that, like, they have so many stats that are analyzed. It's like, make your head spin, right? All these different stats. And then tying that back to mind mapping really kind of goes back to even like elementary school, where they kind of teach you about brainstorming, starting with that bubble in the middle and kind of going off from there. And then mind mapping is being extremely intentional about what that looks like. You know, Stephen Covey comes to mind of us, begin with the end in mind, right? So if you're thinking about, you know, making more sales, well, what goes into that sale, and kind of those steps that you had laid out there, regardless of the industry, that you could overlay on top of that.
Absolutely. So it's just like, for example, your free throw is still higher, and it's still not 100%, even when they have no players coming against them. They have nothing necessarily that is, like, you can say that the audience behind the the basket is distracting, right, or something. But in reality, that's a very minute factor. It's a lot harder to, like, if you look at even the, especially the a more realistic number for what I'm talking about would be how many, like, two pointers or three pointers are they making in that? What is their scoring percentage and that when they're actually in the game, right? Because when you have, that's just like life in essence. And I hate sports, so I don't know why I'm using a sports metaphor, but it is a good metaphor for life, because you will have all sorts of objectives or competition or rivalry that will come against you. That whole goal is to keep you from scoring, to keep you from winning. But as long as you are making consistent efforts towards that goal and towards making those shots, and that it is key for you being successful. And if you are not hauling your weight, per se, then it's not. And it's not like you have to do it alone either. That's the key that a lot of people miss. If you have other teammates, you have other players, and that might be your boss, it might be your coworkers, it might be your employees, it might be your family. Those are all your teammates that you need to get on the same page with to get to the same objective, right? As long as you are both working towards each other. Now, everyone, there's occasionally we get into our self-sabotaging techniques or issues where we want to take all the glory, right? We think that we have to carry the ball and carry the team ourselves. But again, even if you look at those upper players, the people that play the team consistently win more games than the people or the teams that have just one good player. So that is paramount in understanding and helping you be successful and gain expertise and being able to work and consistently win. And that is why it's so important to also surround yourself with like-minded individuals that are going the same direction. That goes the same with religious beliefs, political beliefs, or other stuff and everything. Because if you share some of the same common values, you're going to be working towards the same common. But everybody in your step is at least trying to go the same direction, everything's going to be fine. Now, that doesn't mean, like, especially on my team, everyone has a very different political beliefs, right? Sure. So that's not always a great example. But we at least have the common goal, and the ship that we are on whenever they are in our company is we're at least getting to the same direction where we want to be successful. We want to be able to take care of our families. We value those things. We understand the importance of those relationships and serving the customer. And as long as we can agree on that, we know that all collectively we're moving in the same direction together, which then allows us to move towards success.
Yeah, absolutely. It gives everybody that that common goal to achieve, that rowing in that same direction.
I can't tell you how many companies that I will talk to or deal with. And I will literally talk to the employee who gives zero, like literally zero craps about their job. They will actually badmouth their employer and then brag about the fact that they don't have to do anything. And the only reason they're staying in that job is because they're getting paid a lot of money for basically jack zero effort. Which is like insane to me, because not only is that person extremely toxic, but it shows you. So this is a two-edged sword, right? Companies like that, if you consistently hire, when things go down return, I guarantee those are the people that get laid off first, because they serve no value. And that's when it really comes out, is in a downward economy. It really shows when you literally have to look at the numbers and say, hey, look, I either have to fire people or let them go, or this whole company tanks. And you realize, oh, hey, this person actually does jack diddly for our company. This person does jack diddly. And so all those layoffs that you see in a downward economy is not because those people were indispensable. It's because they were dispensable and they got overconfident or overcocky, or they realized, hey, they actually serve no purpose in that role.
Which is a good reminder that anybody's replaceable, right?
I mean, no. I would arguably say if you structure yourself as an employee or a business owner correctly, and you've built a skill set to where you are undeniably, like, you can do something that other people can't. You consistently execute when other people don't. And even when they're going good, you show up. Like, you don't feel entitled. You do that stuff. Those are the people that can not only have job security, they have the stability to be like, hey, I feel like I deserve a raise at this point. Like, I'm bringing this to the table. I know that my contribution specifically is consistently responsible for, you know, 50% of the revenue. Like, and the thing is when the owner, like, the owner knows who you are, if you are the one that executes on that and executes well enough in that role. The problem is people get content. They sit in the role and they don't really care. They don't settle. And this is why having the mind map and being willing to constantly better yourself.
Yeah.
Because the people that are replaceable are the ones that aren't growing. They aren't achieving. And they're doing the bare minimum to get by. Because there's always someone hungrier or more determined that will step in and kick you in the pants. Like, that's the people that are replaceable. The other people that do step up to the plate, they say, hey, look, my name, my reputation, everything else is worth this much. So I don't care if you're necessarily going to reward me for it. I'm going to show up. I'm going to kill it. And at that point, if the owner doesn't respect that person, they either leave or, again, they'll ask for it. And there's sometimes, in very few, like, if you have a decent boss in that, again, he knows that you are worth every single penny. He knows that you are the driving force in a lot of the revenue. And so it's a simple math equation that says, yeah, you're bringing me 300 grand every single year. I have no problem paying you extra. Right?
Right. And that's almost like an employer mind mapping as well, right? If this, then that, right? If my employee performs this, then I have profits and profitability to invest into that, or to help grow, or to spiff, or to overcompensate, or whatever they do, right?
Yeah. The problem is when you get into employees that, again, will mind map and they'll just say, oh yeah, well, I brought in $10,000 in sales for the day, right? And I'm so great because I closed all 10 grand, but they don't take in consideration, okay, how much was the AdWords cost? The pay-per-click advertising, the events, the foods that you bought for the customer appreciation, the overhead expenses and everything else.
Right.
You're yep. Like, well, our bare minimums break even is 20 grand and you've spent 30 grand just to get that 10 grand. So you might think, oh yeah, I brought in 10 grand of sales and that I'm the best person ever. And it's like, you cost us 30 grand. So the owner is keeping his mouth shut and being like, hey, I'm hoping you're going to learn. And he's taking a huge deficit. But the person thinks that they're, you know, the biggest thing in the seven seas because they just have that limited mentality. So that is the other thing. And that's the other reason that mind mapping is important, is understanding all the factors that come into play. Right. So it's not just about getting the core values of if and that. It's like, hey, what contributes to that? What helps contribute to accomplish these things? What do I really need to do to provide the value to help make this company better? And that's whether you're an employee or the owner. If you look at it, so that's the cool thing about how the universe works, right? The more you give to other people, the more you get, which is, honestly, it almost seems like the most polar opposite ideology and illogical thing humanly possible. However, it's true, because when you consistently give and give and give and give, not only do you have a reputation that follows you, it's like, hey, this guy killed it. He's always been helpful. Yep. He's always been there. He's always done this. He's always performed his job. He's done that. But now you also have all the other so you have reputation, right? You have your not only your reputation, but you have basically the social credit that comes with that, meaning that you go anywhere, people are going to back you up. They're going to give you recommendations. They're going to do this. And you can essentially, once you get to that level, you have the ability to go anywhere you want and do whatever you want because you can. But the thing is people that really stay at that level, it's the same with the NBA, the national stars and that, the ones that stay at the top of their game, when most people are messing around doing all these stupid things and that, they're working on their game, right?
Yep, they're in the gym. Improve.
They're working on their game. They're working in the gym. They're doing all these things. Doesn't mean that they don't have fun, right? But they make sure that for their full 8 hours of every day, they're putting it and giving it 100%.
Right. And numbers of
10%.
Football legend Jerry Rice, he worked harder during practices. So during the games, it made it look like it was a cakewalk for him. And, you know, he worked harder during practice. And so, you know, when are you working harder? When are you giving when you're not, you know, on stage, so to speak, right? It's all the other things that you're doing before you get on stage there.
And so that is the key. And that kind of goes into the play of like, hey, in practice, you should be giving it 120% because that's, again, the preparation and so forth. And that's really, it's not about, oh, hey, I'll give it 100% of the game, because you don't just magically get all your muscles and get all that coordination and everything else. Success, again, comes down to when preparation and hard work meets opportunity, the game being the opportunity, the opportunity being the business deal, the opportunity being the sale, the opportunity being the dream career or job and everything, right?
Absolutely.
So all of these little things, even this podcast, in fact, is all these little jabs, these little bits of value that we're giving. This is the practice for the game of life.
Yeah, you got it. So it all starts with, that mind mapping, getting really, really intentional about everything. And then from there, you have, you know, that I think that kind of leads us into our next probably episode here. From there, once you have that mind mapping laid out, you can start to develop systems around that.
Exactly. So we will catch you guys on the next podcast. Thank you for joining us. Be sure to like and share. And really, if you found value in it, that's all we ask. Just share it, see if we can help. Because if we can help more people, at the end of the day, we collectively, so the tide raises all ships, what it comes down to. So we'll catch you on the next one. Thanks for joining and have a great day.
Peace.